Simplifying resistors can sometimes get very complex very fast. So let's start with the basics on how to simplify a resistor circuit. This particular formation is known as series. So if I have resistance R1 and R2, the effective resistance of this combination would be R1 plus R2. This result can be proved from Ohm's law. Over here, I have a parallel circuit. So if this resistor is R1 and this one's R2, the R equivalent follows from this particular pattern. 1 by R equivalent, or the inverse of R equivalent, equals the sum of the inverses of all of the resistance which are arranged in parallel. So since I have just two resistances over here, I'll just have the sum of the inverses of both of these resistances. If there are more resistances, I could always add just plus 1 by Rn and put a sigma, n from 1 to whatever. But these are the simple cases. What about those complex, crazy, huge resistor mazes? How do we solve them? So let's take a look at a different example over here. Let's say I have this maze. Let's say I have this maze. So how I'll solve this resistor maze is by, well, what they basically want us to find is the effective resistance across AB. I'll call that an RAB. First things first, we'll label the resistors R1, R2, R3 and R4. We've got four resistances here. We'll label all of the points. We'll find out how the potential changes across the circuit. So if this point has a potential of A, then this point should have that same potential. This point should also have the potential of A. This point should also have a potential of A. And from this side, this point should have a potential of B. This point should have a potential of B. And this point should have a potential of B. And so should this point. And this point, well, this point should have a different potential. So let's just call it potential C. Now I can rewrite the circuit. This circuit can become this one. So this is point A and this is point B. So we have B potential, everything which has B potential on this side, and everything which has A potential on this side. A potential R1 has A potential on one side, so we go R1. R4 has A potential on one side, so we write R4. And from the, now we'll come from the B side. R2 has B potential on one side, so this will be R2, and well, R4 has B potential, so we can just connect that directly over there. Now we've got R3. R3 has B potential, so I'll make a new connection over there, R3. R3 has C connection, and so does R1 and R2. So I can just connect the rest of the circuit like that, with this point being C. And I don't have to write that as C, but well, we know C is over there. And now this looks much simpler. R2 parallel to R3 very obviously from the picture, which is in series with R1, and then this whole combination is parallel with R4, and we can just use these basic rules to simplify this circuit, and we can very easily find the effective resistance of this combination. One special case I'd like to talk about is the Wheatstone bridge. So this particular resistor in between both of these points is the bridge resistor. And there's one particular special case of resistances where no current flows through this bridge. That condition is called a balanced Wheatstone bridge. So if I have R1, R2, R3, R4 and R5. And if the ratio of the upper resistances equals the ratio of the lower resistances, well, I shouldn't be calling them upper and lower as such, but well, the ratios of these two resistances along with this point and the ratio of the two resistances along with this point are equal, then no current flows through R5. We can just eliminate it out of the picture. We'll just have R1 and R2 in series and R3 and R4 in series. And the whole thing, both of these things in combination parallel with each other. Now, this thing can be proved with Kirchhoff's laws. I'm not going to go into how the proof goes in this video. But let's also look at the case of an unbalanced Wheatstone bridge. An unbalanced Wheatstone bridge is one where this ratio is not equal. So when this ratio isn't equal, we'll have a little bit of trouble. What we'll have to do is we'll have to make some imaginary wires, connect an imaginary battery to the circuit, and we'll create an imaginary current. So let's say that that imaginary current is I. I goes in, I comes out. That I splits in as I1 and I2 over here. And over here it splits into I3 and I4. The I2 and the I3 come back here as I5. And then comes back and joins in as I. Well, that's a little too many variables. So, well, we'll also have a lot of equations. We'll have to do it through Kirchhoff's laws. We could use some simplification methods like mesh analysis, but this is gonna get really tedious, and generally an unbalanced Wheatstone bridge is avoided. Next, I'd like to talk about input-output symmetry. So this is another extremely special case. So let's say I have this particular circuit. Some random resistance. This is very similar to the Wheatstone bridge which I just discussed now. And well, this is for one particular unbalanced case of Wheatstone bridge. So let's say this resistance is R1, this resistance is R2, this resistance is R1, and this resistance is R2, this resistance is R3. Now if I check out for the ratios, the upper ratio would be R2 by R1 and the lower ratio would be R1 by R2. So unless all of them are equal to 1, this equality is not going to hold. Or unless R1 and R2 happen to be equal, this equality is not going to hold. So let's just assume that it's not equal. So this is an unbalanced Wheatstone bridge condition. If I let that imaginary current which I talked about flow through this particular circuit, let's just say the I splits is I1 and I2 here. And this I1 would split into I2 and I3. Because I2 flows through this particular R2, and that's going to have to be the same I2 that flows through this R2. And well, you guessed it right, I1 flows through this R1. So what basically happens is, there is this particular symmetry in the circuit where we have R1 and we have this bridge connecting. So when I1 current flows through this particular R1, this bridge compensates and ensures that another I1 current flows through this R1, and when I2 current flows through this R2, the bridge ensures that the same I2 current flows through this R2. Again, this can be proved with the help of Kirchhoff's laws, but I'm not going to go through the proof in this video. Another way is the delta Y transform, and this may not help in all cases, but in the cases where it helps a lot. So over here I have this resistance P, Q and R. And over here I have this resistance A, B and C. So basically if I have this kind of a junction anywhere, well, this looks like an inverted Y, a Y, and this looks like the Greek letter delta. So this is called the delta Y transform, and it's basically used as an interconversion from this Y into a delta, or the delta into a Y, and it's given by three formulae. And this result is symmetric and it's really pleasing. Again, this can be proved using Kirchhoff's laws, but Kirchhoff's laws, or you can even use mesh analysis, but I'm not gonna go into the proof over here. So basically P equals AB divided by A plus B plus C. Q equals AC by A plus B plus C. And R equals BC by A plus B plus C. And that's when I want to transfer the delta into the Y. This is for delta to Y. And let's have the other case now. The Y to the delta. So A equals PQ by R plus P plus Q. B equals PR by Q plus P plus R, and C equals QR by P plus Q plus R. And that's the delta Y transformation. And coming to the last method, this one is my most favorite method. I'll call it the folding symmetry method. And this method is the bomb. So let's say I have resistance X over here and another same X over here, Y over here, and Y over here, Z over here, and Z over here, AB, this doesn't really matter. So if you notice, there is a very obvious symmetry across this line. And what we'll do over here is we'll fold the circuit. What we'll do is bring this part of the circuit like that. So we just fold the circuit, and the circuit now becomes, we'll retain everything about the axis of symmetry. So A is retained and B is retained because they're both about the axis of symmetry. What happens to the elements that get folded is stunning, and this is a result purely because of symmetry. If these resistances are not equal, mind, you cannot apply this rule. But when they're equal, I'm folding an X onto an X, so it becomes an X by 2. I'm folding a Y onto a Y, becomes a Y by 2. Folding a Z onto a Z, and it becomes a Z by 2. And now, well, I could apply whatever I want. I could apply nodal analysis, or I could apply Kirchhoff's law, or I could apply a Wheatstone bridge, a balanced case if it happens to be the case. Or I could apply whatever. But, well, this circuit just got converted to a smaller one, and that's how we simplify resistors. Getting from a crazy circuit like this to a single resistor, single equivalent resistance to cover the whole of this particular circuit is what simplifying resistors is about. I hope this video taught you something and helped you understand and find out the various different ways in which we can get a complex circuit to a simple one.